Se sono fatti sul pari va bene.
Sono sempre in piedi così, eh?
This piece, in white Montorfano and pink Baveno granite, water and iron, a work of open sculpture, articulated horizontally and vertically, but not a piece of architecture, measures 18 meters by 18 at the base and is more than 8 meters 60 high from the bottom of the base. The initial project of the Anello di Taino, as it was called in the early projects, became, over the years, the locus of the four cardinal points. From the center rises the great gnomon, dedicated to Apollo, the Greek god whose great sanctuary, as we know, was in Greece, in Delphi. This work is connected with the apparent movements of the real sun, and the giant columnomon is for determining, by its shadow, the passage of time on the days of the equinoxes and solstices. On June the 21st, in fact, around noon, rays of the sun from behind the pilaster penetrate through an inclined opening cut into the body of the pilaster, marking for only a few minutes with its light the summer solstice, completely obscuring the iron pyramidal tip of the fallen pilaster, except for a part sculpted in a notch which remains illuminated very briefly. The entire place is an abode, with the visible and invisible traces of Hermetic tradition, because not everything is written in the stones. In fact, it is also a constructive knot of numerical and dimensional relationships, inside and outside the work, which is related to the stars above. The work itself, as a whole, is regulated by numerical and dimensional relationships according to the ancient rule of the golden section, well evidenced by the iron elements fixed in the wall and placed at the top of the stair. This rule works for the entire work like a pivot, which allows each individual part to rotate around it, like a miniature planetary system around its sun. The place attracts birds as well as men. The elderly sit on the stones, and in the summer, children bathe in the basin. But above all, it is, or can be, a privileged place for a pause for reflection, or for contemplation in solitude, or even in company. The Taino Park is dedicated to peace, as is written on the small red granite pillar at the entrance. The pillar is hexagonal, and lines from the last canto of Dante's Inferno are engraved on it. And then we went out again to see the stars, out of the swamp, away from that pond of croaking frogs who ignore the unfathomable profundity of the universe. This is how I would bear witness to my great debt to Florence, contracted far back in 1951 to 52, where around Piazza della Signoria, the Museum of the Opera del Duomo, the Bargello, the sacristies of San Lorenzo and the Accademia, I was initiated, without knowing it, to sculpture. During the entire period of my military service, I passed long hours and days in those very places, populated by the works of great artists. I have been convinced for so long now that we others haven't done anything more than stir up the cinders of that great fire that was lit in Florence. And it was a miraculous fire, with the ancient logs of the great Greek woods of the 6th and 5th centuries BC. Words, one might say, spoken by a classicist, if not actually a traditionalist. Except, as you will see, the basis of his formation as a sculptor was of another nature, not museum or academically related. Exactly 40 years ago, Gio participated for the first time in the biennial exhibit in Venice with his brother Arnaldo. Marco Valsecchi described that debut. Gio, the youngest and intellectually most restless, said that he had thought up one of his informal hieroglyphics while reading Ezra Pound's The Pisan Cantos. That is, the push came from the rhythm, the unforeseen torsion of images, in a sense full of a kind of Baroque emotivity, and finally from that ability to take advantage, through assonance and quick mirror views, of such different suggestions of facts, fantasies, and variously placed references. This was an adventurous way to use, with renewed marvel, the great mine of the past. Actually, the immediate stimuli were others. The cues were in the immediate present, that is, from Klee's microcosm, from the matter fibrillation of the informal, as well as, in the most recent past, the tension and dynamism of the futurists, the great lesson of Boccioni, the sculptor, the mental severity of constructivism, Tatlin, Gabo, and Pevsner, the sparkling casuality of the cubist works, and, finally, the refined forms of Brancusi and Arp. So it was that the first sculptures of Gio were born. Reliefs with positive and negative signs, capturing a bit of all the cited postulates of modernity. He defined the first works crescite, growths, then fluidità contrapposte, contrasting fluidities, and finally, it was to be expected, superfici in tensione, surfaces under tension, as if animated from within, moved by an existential dynamic, poised in an illusion of perpetual motion. The beginning of the 1970s presented an even more acute challenge for Joe, one that continues today. Following the supreme example of Michelangelo, he continues to chisel ever more monumental forms out of stone and Apuan marble. The research on surfaces under tension had quieted, and the phase of projecting a sculpture from the block began from the nucleus of the block of stone, the barely squared and compact block, which, however, did not hinder the artist from seeing a dense network of orthogonal coordinates, conceived as the warp and weft of a three-dimensional mass. Once he had abandoned his first method of working, he needed to put more emphasis on the projection stage. In fact, with the nucleus of the stone as the point of departure, it was indispensable to think about both the outside and the internal parts of the work, that is, that mysterious space, so dear to Eduardo Chillida, which is inside a sculpture even when it is comprised of an inaccessible block. He began to work in Versilia, chiseling Apuan marble. His indispensable companions in this task were the artisan master stonecutters, trees among trees, and altogether they make the forest. The master stonecutter knew how to move immense weights gently, as if they were feathers, transforming them into dynamic forces that became wings on the blocks of stone, making them turn like immense but gentle millstones. He knew all about levers, rollers, squares, plumb lines, fundamental geometry, like what regulates the movement of the stars. An expert of the language, mysterious to many, on projects and calculations of statics, he raised the perfect forests of the cities of God, cathedrals, temples, solar obelisks, and the immense monuments of power. Triangulator of tridimensional maps, he knew the routes that led him towards the fabulous figures buried in the blocks. Living with these people, as I did, one learns a lot about sculpture, more than by educated bookish exegesis. The double structure of empty-full, internal-external, directions, complex relationships, statics or dynamics of the system of weights and proportions of forms, each tiny part with respect to the whole and vice versa, the entire system of resonances and sensorial involvements, the terms of occupation of real tridimensional space, including distances, extensions and juxtapositions, the fulcrums of radiating energy or spiral movements, tension and torsion. All of this is in play, closed in the total dimension of the stone block. This is the place of an amorous challenge, where defeat is more frequent than victory. It is a place of shadows from which it is difficult to extract a gleam of light to illuminate us. We move around this place together, from the quarryman to the truck driver, even the unknown descendants of the nomad hunters of our origins, extracting something to live on, as in those remote times. I suspect that the first sculpture was a coarsely chipped flintstone. Thank you. the sun, Helios, which, rising in the sky, sees all things. Helios, who illuminated the stormy loves of Ares and Aphrodite. Helios, whom Dionysus declared the greatest of all. Helios, whom Zeus prohibited from shining for a time when he saw the giant's stones and burning brand irons hurling through the sky. A series of five sculptures here in Florence remind us of the myth of the sun. As the artist himself warned, these forms are heraldic and symbolic representations of the real sun, considered works without owners. The sun belongs to everybody. They are made from cylindrical drums of varying thickness, but proportional to the ray. The sculptor never abandons Euclidean care. He remains attentive to everything related to science and physics. References to Galileo are declared numerous times. The projects for these figures of the sun are developed according to symbolic valences of the fundamental numbers and take into account the values of symmetry and opposition of contraries. They go back to the key which governs the structure, that is, the spiral, a constant factor in this lucid and tenacious work method. The sun is sight, the first day of creation, warmth and light, everything that restores, like gold and molasses. It is the heart of man, which emanates natural and spiritual warmth, the pulsating soul, which instills warm spirits in the body's arteries, as the sun in the sky makes the earth give forth vapor, generating the mist and dew, which it then returns to the earth with its movement. The sun is the formal cause of seed. It is the heart in the chest and the right eye on the face. It is the ring finger on the hand, the English doctor finger, whose sensitive tip was considered to be connected to the heart. According to the Tantra, the left one is discipline, the right method. Sometimes the sun is represented by the black crow, iridescent, with its powerful flight and frequent glides, whose call, according to the ancients, had 54 variations and was used for the prophecies of Apollo. The solar crow talked in Mitra's ear, the force which makes vegetation die and then come to life again. The rooster and sometimes the spider are also attributed to the sun. And since cows and bulls go out at dawn as if pushed by the sun, they are synonyms of the sun's rays in scripture and in Greece. The oldest motive is the deposed sun. This monumental work was done using the mold of the one in Trani stone and donated by Joe Pomodoro to his hometown, Orciano di Pesaro. The base of the work is an integral constituent part of the entire monument, and the sun lies on it strongly inclined along the central axis. The solar stair, done in 1988, comprises an even more schematic and geometric model of the solar system, which well explains the explicit dedication to Kepler. The bulky mass of the Sun occupies one of the fires of the elliptical base, such that the apparent gravitational motion determines the orbit, just as the German astronomer individuated in his first law. This sculpture was the preparatory study for the large stone monument installed at the University of Tel Aviv in 1993. Inscribed on the base is Kepler's motto, Ubi materia, ibi geometria. Where there is matter, there is geometry. The Sun Serpent is a study that served for the realization of two large monumental works executed at the end of the 1980s. One, the large sculpture Sun Aerospace, is in bronze and is installed in Piazza Adriano in Turin. And the other, Sun Serpent, made with radiant white statuary marble, is at the Yorkshire Sculpture Park in England. Iconologically, the work belongs to the classical theme of the Sun Serpent, known to historians of ancient art, the symbol of the fight between light and shadow, the solid element and air, order and chaos, just to name a few of the pairs to which it refers. The sun shines and radiates light. When it is at the zenith, it annuls in its glare the colors of the rainbow. But before it includes those thousand wonderful pigments in its splendor, it allows the artist to halt the kaleidoscope with a painting. They are paintings of a sculptor, dense with plasticity, with volumes, with thickness. The forms advance imperious from the pages, whirl in the illusory lake of color, answer to severe laws of perspective. Maria Luigia Guaita tells of the meeting with Joe Pomodoro 35 years ago in Florence. The first artist who, under the guidance of Rudolfo Magheri, drew on those lithographic stones, sought for and found by Magheri himself, and lovingly prepared to embrace the mark of the artist by an excellent printer, was Joe Pomodoro. It was 1961, and I had founded with five friends the Bisonte Press, with the scope of printing original lithographs of young abstract artists, and of introducing into the Italian market the art graphic, as I had seen was fashionable in England. My enthusiasm infected my friends, and it was in fact one of them who brought to the Bisonte the young, fair-haired man that was Joe Pomodoro 35 years ago. He arrived one clear, very cold morning, as there can be in Florence.
Un artista è un essere che pensa.
The artist is a being who thinks continuously about the trauma of his birth, about how much better it was to be inside the egg.
Stranamente, l'uovo assomiglia a una lastra da incidere.
Strangely, the egg resembles an incision plate because it is black.
Credo che per fare veramente, per abbordare bene la questione dell'incisione.
I think that in dealing with the problem of incision, it is best not to trust any other type of inking. Black is appropriate because black is the cosmic void. It is the very obscure void in which the being to be born is inside the egg.
Oscuro nel quale l'essere che deve ancora nascere è dentro l'uovo. Però, stranamente,
however, strangely, this black is related to the white of the paper, light and shadow, sun and darkness. This is the portion of space in our galaxy.
E l'oscurità. Questa è la porzione di spazio della nostra galassia.
Imagine that here, in every tiny spot, there are light years of distance. This is an extraordinary magic space. Here, within the infinitely small, is the dimension of the infinitely vast. I want you to know that this is the space within which you, ab ovo, inside the maternal egg, are still sovereign. You are the ones who experiment in full the possibilities of liberty.
Siete coloro che sperimentano in pieno la possibilità della libertà.
Whatever you do inside this black space will merit having been done. If you have the sense, completely, secularly holy, that this is the area for which you can say, I am the sovereign of this territory, of this black space, and here I can do everything that is freely possible to do.
Io sono il sovrano di questo territorio, di questo spazio nero. Io qui dentro farò tutto quello che è liberamente possibile fare.